Penguin Random House Audio presents Why Didn't You Tell Me? A Memoir. This is the author, Carmen Rita Wong. For my brother, Alex Aldo Dado Wong. When you bury the truth, you bury it alive. A note to listeners. This is my story as I best remember it and as it has shaped me. This is not the truth, but my truth. I've changed names and characteristics to protect some and to not give satisfaction to others. This is in no means a full account of my life or the lives of the people in it. There are hundreds more memories where these come from, but you'll get the gist. Prologue. My youngest sister only recently gave me a photograph that she found in our dad's closet. If I had seen it at any point in my first 3 decades on this earth, it would have burst my life and our family's lives wide open. It had to have been taken in 1971 because the swaddled baby that my mother's holding in the photo is me, and I'm a newborn. The scene is on a narrow terrace of an apartment in Manhattan. My mother Lupe stands in semi-profile in what looks like the late afternoon sun. To the left in the photo is the man I knew later in life as my stepfather, Marty, holding another baby, the son of the tall woman in the middle of the photo. This woman's arms are open to the friends on each side of her, her afro the apex of the photo staging. I'd been told all my life that my stepfather, the man in the picture, didn't know my mother when I was born. So why was he in this picture? Why were we, my mother and I, with his friends? And why was this photo just surfacing now? Seeing this photograph 2 years ago, it was like finding one of the biggest clues in a long unsolved case. And by the time I saw it, I knew only some of the truths it revealed. The name on my birth certificate for father is Peter Tinglet Wong. At the time of the photo, my mother, Guadalupe Altagracia, and Peter, Papi, were married. I was raised as their child, as a Wong. But there in the photo was my mother, a married woman, standing on a terrace holding me, her Dominican Chinese baby, with a man who was not her husband and not my father, a white man. This should be a happy photo celebrating two new little humans brought into this world. So why does my mother look like her heart is breaking? As if in her expression, I can hear her say to herself as she looks at me, her new baby girl, what have I done? The truth she held behind her eyes that day, it would unfold over decades and have repercussions that she never could have imagined. Chapter 1, Because the Stage Was Set. One of my first memories is being dolled up one night in a miniature rabbit fur chubby coat made by my abuela, my mother's mother, whom we called Mama. She was an elegant, square-faced, handsome Dominican woman who kept her deep black straight hair in a short chic cut, never leaving the house without red lipstick. She worked in Midtown Manhattan as a seamstress for Oscar de la Renta. The suave, perpetually tanned Dominican-American fashion designer with a legacy of dressing first ladies, starting with Jackie Kennedy, and who filled his workshops with immigrant women from his home country. Abuela dressed for work every day in a smart, tailored navy or black Oscar skirt suit and a starched white or cream-collared blouse. She was divine to me. My chubby coat was calico. In color, it was uneven. There were variations in the length of the fur pieces, all shades of brown from light to dark, patchy like a calico cat. It was sewn of remnants from Mama's salon, a manufacturing loft filled with her fellow countrywomen, who were most likely also various shades of brown and black. Speaking to the island's history of enslavement and colonialism as old as Columbus's first landing. I couldn't have been more than 3, almost 4 years old that night. But what I remember most was the feel of that fur, the absolute luxe of it, unspoiled by any knowledge of the carnage that happened to put it on my back. And I remember that in wearing that coat, along with my fancy lace-up go-go boots, an emerald green velvet evening purse, also custom-made for me with a rabbit's fluffy gray tail smack in the middle of the clasp, I felt like the most loved and special thing. I remember it so well because it was a feeling that was rare and would be gone from my life all too soon. I was dressed up to go out with my older brother, Alexander, Alex to everyone except our parents, to Chinatown with our father, Peter Poppy Wong. He was coming to pick us up from our apartment in Morningside Heights, which at the time, the 1970s, was Harlem. My brother and I lived alone with our young mother, Lupe, a firstborn child in her father's second family. My grandfather, Abuelo, had two families, one with his wife, who was somewhere else in New York City at the time, and one with his longtime, let's call her partner, my grandmother, Mama. It was decades before I'd find out that this was typical of Dominican culture back then, and it's handed down still a bit today. For a man to have a wife, never divorce, but have another family, or more, and even live with this other family, like my grandfather did. Of course, this was never spoken of. And I didn't meet anyone from Abuelo's other legitimate family, our family, until nearly 30 years later. Ay, mija, qué linda eres, Abuela said to me as she bent down to put the hook into the eye at the top of my coat. She would say this phrase to me like a mantra, that night and every day that I was lucky enough to see her. Qué linda. Her greeting to me was always this. And what I heard was, oh, my child, how lovely you are. It could never have been said to me enough. But it wasn't about my appearance. When Mama held my face in her hands, she looked into my being and told me, that I was worthwhile, even with all she could see inside me, just as I was and as all I was to be. No one before or since has done the same. But at 3 or 4, the prime years in which we shape and form ourselves, our personalities and our programming, that was all I needed to build a foundation for the adventure and struggle that was to be the rest of my life. I hear my abuela's voice so clearly in my memories, but I find it a bit strange that I don't remember my mother's voice at all before the age of maybe 5 or 6. Her silence, or my perception of it, is a striking impression from my childhood. I can see her clearly, though. I saw my mother, Mommy, Lupe, that night at the end of the narrow and dimly lit railroad apartment hallway, holding open the door for my brother and me. Both of us kids all gussied up and fresh and clean for a night out on the town with our Chinese father, who didn't live with us. Poppy and Mommy were still married, but separated. Abuela had kissed me on the cheek and turned me around to follow Alex down the hall to the door. My jaunty boots clip-clopped on the linoleum. Mommy held the door open to Poppy, but didn't let him in. He was a bit thin then and small, maybe 5'5", looking like an Asian Johnny Cash, dressed all in black, a slick fitted jacket, more biker than suit, hair brill creamed back into a low, shiny black pompadour. As Poppy spoke, he embraced us each with one arm, like we were buddies. He always did that. Come on, come on, there's my daughter. Here's my son. Okay, okay, let's go. Ready to eat? You hungry? I'm sure we got to Chinatown, 9 or 10 miles downtown by car, Poppy's preferred mode of transportation. Later, I would find out why he always had a car or van. Let's just say that it was job-related. Our two closest cousins lived on the street that intersected ours in a building we could see from our windows. They also had a father not living with them who was Chinese, un chino. I remember that he had a car too, one we'd see parked in front of either their building or ours. No one in our Dominican family had a car, though. The restaurant was overwhelming in size, filled with gold chairs as far as my eyes could see, and red, so much red, and people and chatter everywhere. Eyes were on us. When our father, Peter Wong, entered a space, no matter the expanse, he made sure you heard and saw him coming. Chinese Johnny Cash was a star, you see, in his mind. And he was being followed by his two darker, not very Asian-looking children, but two children who looked very much like each other. Big brown eyes, tan-colored skin, black curly hair. Though my brother carried a hint of the Asian fold in his eyelids that would grow more pronounced over time, along with enviably lush lashes. We were just two little brown kids who looked like full siblings, black, white, and gold. "Aye," Peter greeted every server, host, male person, standing or not, that he passed. He rattled off in whatever dialect was applicable to whomever he was addressing. Poppy was Taiwanese-born, of Chinese descent, a former merchant marine who worked as a chef on a Norwegian shipping vessel. One day, he stepped off his ship as it docked at a pier in Manhattan.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.